Hi, I'd like to introduce myself. I'm Kevin Krewell. I'm a member of the Semiconductor SIG at the Computer History Museum. Today is July 31st, 2015, and we're at the Computer History Museum. And we're about to interview Dave Ditzel, who's probably best known as the founder of Transmeta, but also an early researcher in RISC processor design at UC Berkeley. He's also worked at Bell Labs, AT&T Bell Labs, and at Sun Micro. Those are probably his most well-known attributes, or say his well-known jobs.
Even at Intel.
That's probably less well-known.
Yeah.
Most people were surprised. When
I wasn't allowed to talk about what I was doing there.
In fact, I don't know if you still can.
Well, a little bit.
No. So let's start off with a little background on Dave, and then we'll work into his history, and fascinating history, actually. But we're going to start off just a little bit about family background. Why don't you just give us a little growing up and where you were born and raised, and how you started life?
Yeah. Generally, I grew up in the Midwest, and Missouri and Iowa. My father was a chemical engineer, so kind of, well-trained, university-educated parents encouraged me to read, and I got very interested in science from a young age. Had a big workshop in the house, so I was always tinkering with things and got into doing a lot of electrical types of things. So I was very good at wiring stuff up
one way or another.
I used to probably only in maybe fourth, fifth, sixth grade repair televisions for the neighbors. And at that point in time,
did you have your own tube tester, or did you go down to the store?
No, I go to the store and find a tube tester. Quite often, what would be wrong with the TV? It'd be a tube would be out, and you could tell because the filament wasn't lit up, and that was enough. You didn't need a tube tester. So I collected old televisions that didn't work, took them apart, had a big inventory of electronics parts, and got interested in amateur radio. I ended up building a lot of amateur radio gear, but found that I was more interested in building the electronics than actually talking on the radio when I got it done. While I was doing that, I also got introduced to programming. Probably fifth grade was probably the first time I wrote a computer program, when there was something called a teletype model 33 teletype writer. It was fairly
so your
slow.
Had a access line?
Our school had a timeshare access to a little system, so I got introduced to the basic programming language, and then in junior high school ended up doing a lot more and got torn between electronics and programming. And so my whole career has been kind of a trade-off between hardware and software, and not being willing to give up either one.
Well, that's been perfect, because that actually has been the nexus of those two areas where you've been very successful.
It's helped me to be successful and see trade-offs that sometimes software people don't see hardware issues, and hardware people don't know exactly how software works, and so it's helped me in thinking about processors. But even from a very early age, I was very interested in computers and tried to build my own. From maybe even be only 12 years old, I tried to build a card punch reader. I took little 3x5 cards, punched holes in them, and it would light up a set of ray of lights on the board, and I could say, what's 3 times 5? And the answer 15 would be punched into the card. You'd put it in the machine, and the little reader would read it, and would light up 15, and I would impress all my parents and friends as to how I'd built a computer. Now, that did get more sophisticated and turn into real computers later. And about the time I was finishing high school, the world was getting the first 8-bit single-chip microprocessors. And that was a very exciting time, and so I ended up building my own homebrew computer system, learned how to build all the pieces, wired my own CPU board, memory board, storage system, paper tape reader, wired my own keyboard up to it.
Where'd you get the information for? Did you get the data sheets from?
There was a lot of hobby activity in that time, but there was a magazine called Byte Magazine, and I remember getting issue number 1 of Byte Magazine that said how to, build your own computer. And so as those came out monthly, and you learned to read data sheets and put stuff together, a lot of it was just inventing it yourself. It wasn't terribly complicated. And people had very clever schemes, like how to use your audio tape recorder to plug in the microphone jack and record programs with sounds. There was enough performance in the processors to drive different audio frequencies. And people were pretty ingenious at little homebrew pieces to build computers. And so I had access to timeshare computers in my high school. Mm-hmm. I also was very fortunate. I lived in a university town while in high school in Ames, Iowa, the home of Iowa State University. And so I only lived a few minutes from the university, and I ended up in the summers getting jobs. And I got a job with one of the local computer research labs, working on something called the Symbol computer system. So I was to be able to get in and play with a computer that normally only graduate students and professors got to deal with while I was in high school. And that, plus being able to build my own computer and tinker around, I think I was actually pretty involved for people at that time to actually do a lot of programming, both hardware and software, still while in a high school age.
Oh yeah, especially in that time period. That was extremely unusual to have that kind of access. Yeah. Access at that time.
Yeah, so I would go and spend 10 hours a day in the computer lab. You know, I'd get off school and go and spend till 1 or 2 in the morning doing programming. And in the summers, work full time. So initially helping out, but I got better at what I was doing. I ended up going to school at Iowa State later and kind of kept that job to help pay my way through school. But it really introduced me to some fairly deep concepts in computer architecture much earlier than most students would have gotten. Mm-hmm. And so that helped me form a lot of ideas. The Symbol computer was particularly interesting because it was a very early attempt, a machine designed by Fairchild Semiconductor in the early 1960s, to try and do a new kind of generation of architecture that reduced the semantic gap between programming languages and hardware. And so they had almost a one-to-one mapping between elements in the programming language and elements in a binary format that was there.
And it was a custom programming language.
It was a special programming language they invented for that machine. All arithmetic was done in decimal arithmetic, variable length up to 99 digits of precision. Mm-hmm. The machine only had basic data types of strings and structures, and a number was just a type of string that was held. And you could add to it, or you could string operations on it. And this whole machine, what's really amazing about it is it had basically an operating system, a compiler, time-shared terminals where you could get access, and all of this was done completely in individual logic gates. You know, where there were small, what's called a dual inline package was invented for that machine. You only got 2 NAND gates per package, roughly, mm-hmm. Or 1 flip-flop. And there was no microcode ROM at all. There was no software operating system for the machine. You would turn it on, and the machine would sequence through a set of state machines and run your program that way. And so while it was a fascinating concept, it introduced me early to this notion of high-level language computer architecture and doing very complex operations, something we later call complex instruction set computers. And that working on a machine like that for several years helped me think about doing the opposite of something we later called reduced instruction set computers.
Right, CISC versus RISC.
And Dave Patterson at UC Berkeley and I wrote a paper called The Case for RISC, which kind of reintroduced the notion of building very simple but fast machines as a better way to do computing than somehow trying to add all this complexity to the hardware to try and help out the programmer. I mean, the end goal is still the same. You want to run the user's program well, but fundamentally it doesn't really matter what level the ops are. The question is, how do you do it the best way?
Mm. But before you got to RISC, you did a lot of exploration and a lot of research on these very complex instruction set machines.
Well, I got to work on the Symbol computer, which is a very complex machine, and I did a lot of programming while at the university on IBM 360s, Digital Equipment Corporation, PDP-11s, and other machines. So I kind of knew machines from the standard machines from the assembly language level as well as where to go. And I guess my mission in life at the time was to figure out how to design better computers.
Yeah.
And it's something I've had a passion for my whole life from a very young age, maybe 10, 12 years old, up through today. It's something I just can't let go of.
Well, it's a lifelong avocation or vocation for you, I should say. But just before we leave the Symbol project, That machine never really made it into a large-scale commercial.
Never made it into market. It was started by Fairchild, and before the project was finished, they ended up canceling it. They transferred the 90% finished machine to Iowa State University, who ended up getting it working and spent the next maybe 5 to 10 years trying to get bugs out of the machine. You can imagine if there's a bug in software, you go and you edit it and you recompile, and it's very quick. But in this machine, you actually, when you found a bug, you actually had to go in and solder wires on the board and change the logic gates. And so it really drove home the notion that software programmability is much easier when you don't have something specified absolutely perfectly at the beginning rather than completely hardwiring something.
Yeah. But and then that machine had some disadvantages as well. In addition to the complexity, in fact, you had to physically change the design to make it to fix a bug. I think you also indicated we talked earlier, it also ran fairly slowly.
It used a lot of chips. There were 20,000 individual chips in there.
Yeah.
And I think for me, the impetus for reduced instruction set computing was to say, well, what if you would use those 20,000 chips in a different way?
Yeah.
Instead of doing one instruction that may take 10,000 clocks serially and then going on to the next one, what if you built a pipelined instruction set that was very simple and had overlap? And so a lot of those ideas, coming from simple and complex instruction sets and what didn't work well were formative in some of the ideas that moved toward early RISC ideas, at least on my part. Okay. There were a lot of other people thinking about RISC concept in those ideas as well, and the whole notion kind of gelled around the 1980 timeframe when Dave Patterson and I wrote the case for RISC. There were great debates that were held for several years at conferences of this is, first it's a totally stupid idea, and then, well, it kind of makes sense in some situations, and then later on eventually takes over as everybody saying, well, yes, of course, we all understood this was the right thing to do.
Yeah. Well, before we jump ahead, let's just stick a little more chronologically, because after Iowa State, you wound up going to work for AT&T Bell Labs, is that correct?
I did. I took a job at AT&T Bell Labs, and part of the reason I took it there is they offered to pay up for my graduate school education.
Right. Good deal.
So, how I ended up getting connected up there was there were some recruiters on campus, and I said, look, I'm interested in building a machine for the C programming language, and they said, oh, we have a group actually in our research group in Murray Hill that's looking at this. We'll connect you up. And so as a undergraduate, I got an interview for the group that typically only hired very senior PhDs, and I ended up being the youngest, professional engineer they had ever hired into that team. And this was a little group of 30 people at Bell Laboratories, which was maybe 50 to 100,000 people, very large organization.
Yeah.
But this is the small group that invented the UNIX operating system, the C programming language, C++, UNIX networking. And we did early RISC microprocessors together in a team. It was about 30 different people that did a lot of these different things. So it was a great and exciting time to explore a lot of different options if you could do your study project with just a couple of people.
So that was must have been a little bit pretty much kept you busy between your graduate work and that project.
Yeah, so I ended up, Bell Labs sent me to UC Berkeley, or helped me to go there. I had to get in on my own.
Yeah.
But I chose Berkeley to work for Dave Patterson, who also studied high-level language computer architecture.
Mm-hmm.
And so I had a great time there. Berkeley had accepted a very large number of graduate students those particular years, and therefore they could put a large number of people on a project, something that, say, companies could do, maybe 50 people on a project. And Dave Patterson and a couple of the other professors there were just extremely good at organizing this large number of students, motivating them into something coherent. And that's how the various series of RISC projects at Berkeley got going.
Was that DARPA funding, or partially at least?
I'm not sure exactly where all the funding came from. I think it maybe was a combination of NSF, DARPA, a few other places. As students, you don't really worry about that. you just wonder whether you have an office and are being paid and can take classes.
Yeah. And how was it working with Dave Patterson?
But Dave Patterson was absolutely great. Really a great visionary leader, very motivational, great at setting up various events where the students would come. He'd bring in outside industry people. And so it was really a superb place to get an education. He's done just a number of absolutely great things over his career, and it was a pleasure for me to be able to work with him for a while, as well as after I graduated after I had been at Bell Labs for a while, I moved to Sun Microsystems. And one of my first tasks at Sun Microsystems was to actually hire and work with Dave Patterson as a consultant. He'd actually had been working with Sun for a while.
Yeah.
And he was helping Sun on the Spark architecture,
yeah,
which was kind of a next evolutionary step from the Berkeley RISC I and RISC II architectures.
Yeah, Sun, I guess, started off using 68,000s, I believe.
Yeah, Sun started off as a company using the Motorola 68,000 processor,
yeah,
but they kind of saw the wave of RISC processors coming.
Mm-hmm.
And I think they had the brilliant insight, this is done by Bill Joy, Andy Bechtel-Simon, some others, to say, well, let's, if the RISC architecture is simple, let's open it up and give it away. And we'll have lots of people help us implement this. And so when I was at Sun, I was the CTO for the Spark architecture as part of the Spark technology business. It was very exciting because instead of having one company do one CPU project, there were maybe 10 or 15 companies all doing different Spark projects, all hoping to get some of Sun's business. In the end, this was great for Sun because they could just pick off the best of whatever resulted from this.
Yeah.
They got more innovation that way, and so things moved very quickly in the industry. The other thing that was really great about RISC processors, and it's at Sun, for example, the very first Spark CPU was done by just two engineers.
Because it's a simple design. So
fairly simple design. Today, having been at Intel, you would have several hundred engineers working in one way or another to try and do a new project like that. So it allowed a lot of different companies, RISC, that is, allowed a lot of different companies to go off and to build their own CPUs, to try out different things.
Mm-hmm.
There was a lot of innovation in the industry. And I think it really helped propel things forward at a great rate.
Okay. Well, we've jumped ahead again. I'd like to actually back up again to Berkeley because there was some other stuff
mm-hmm.
you did at Berkeley, the X-Tree system, and there was some other stuff you were involved in there. So maybe you want to talk a little bit about what you did there in addition to...
Well, largely I was studying and taking classes.
Yeah.
But there was a research project. What I worked on was called X-Tree, and I did a processor proposal for X-Tree.
Yeah.
It was a tagged architecture. I tried to take some of the ideas that I'd seen in the symbol computer system and try and do kind of a more modern version of that to see if we could make it better. And I think in the end, my conclusion was, as much as I had tried to put advanced concepts at the time, like tagged architectures and descriptors and other things in the machine, that the notion of a simple RISC machine in the end actually ended up being more appealing. So I did the good thing as a student, which is I wrote up my thesis on the X-Tree processor. But immediately after that, I wrote up what I call my anti-thesis, which is we wrote the case for RISC, which said, we've been studying this field of high-level language computer architecture, and as we're working on it, we're not so sure it's really the right path. And so I think that's really what started the movement back towards simpler architectures. If that hadn't happened, who knows what kind of complex machines we might have today.
Well, there was the other RISC projects going on in Stanford and IBM, and
yeah.
So I mean, it seemed to be a number of different researchers came to the same conclusion, and mostly because they did share information.
Yeah.
But it quickly became.
Yeah, I'll tell you one quick story about IBM, which is IBM had an early RISC project called the 801.
Right.
801 was actually just the building number for IBM T.J. Watson research,
yeah,
but it was called the 801 machine for that reason. For quite a long time, the management at IBM didn't allow people to publish about this, but rumors were getting out about this particular computer about the same time. And I was actually involved in starting a number of conferences. One of the conferences was Architectural Support for Programming Languages and Operating Systems.
Mm-hmm.
And the rumors had gotten out, and this certainly helped at AT&T and others, that IBM had this incredible RISC processor that was 10 times faster than anything else out there. And if you didn't get into RISC now, IBM would totally dominate the industry. And so I think that actually motivated other people to do that.
Oh.
At one point, though, one funny story is that we tried to get IBM to submit a paper for the ASPLOS conference, and they actually submitted, and then later they were denied being able to publish it, right? And so I wrote a paper to the head of IBM research and said, look, everybody's doing work in this field. We just want to give IBM credit that it's due for doing this early work, right? I remember the IBM in the end did give permission, and somebody told me the story later that they had taken my letter, stapled it on another letter, at IBM that said roughly, it's come to a sad state of affairs when Bell Labs is out to protect the reputation of IBM, simply because we wanted to be able to cite them appropriately for the great work that they had done with John Koch and Marty Hopkins and others who had worked on the IBM 801 machine. I think really had done a very nice job of that. But some of the ideas, what's the basic idea is out. Groups like the Berkeley RISC One team were able to do kind of equivalent RISC architectures that were equally good, and as well as many other companies, Sun, MIPS. I can name a host of small companies that all had their own RISC architecture because it's something you could do with a small number of engineers.
Yeah, relatively straightforward design, didn't require a lot of microcode, so there was a lot of advantages on a silicon implementation point of view.
Yeah.
But it put a lot more burden on the software side, because you had the compilers had to be more aware of and handle more.
Well,
of the work.
I think maybe it's misunderstood. One of the quotes I like best about compilers was an issue between MIPS and Spark maybe was that Spark had register windows to make it easier on compilers, and John Tennessee, who had founded MIPS, said, "Look, a compiler is only an issue until you have it written. Once it's done, you don't really have an issue with the compiler anymore," and. In many ways, the flat register file that MIPS uses as a model was fairly easy for compilers to use. Mm-hmm. And they could do a very good job of optimization with that. Mm-hmm. The register windows took a lot of chip area at the time. Mm-hmm. And so while there are some good concepts there, depending on the implementation of your technology you're using, it could vary. But again, I think once you have compilers, you're pretty much insulated from a lot of the details of the instruction set, and so really it didn't seem to matter so much whether you had a RISC-like instruction set or a VAX-like instruction set. I think it had less impact on software programmers than people had initially assumed it might, particularly as the world moved to high-level programming languages. And again, you have to remember just slightly earlier than the RISC days, people were still questioning whether you could actually use high-level languages effectively for performance. There are still a lot of people writing in assembly language.
Yeah. even C was considered slow by some people.
Yeah.
And C's a very low-level language.
Yeah, so complex instruction sets like you had on the Digital Equipment Corporation, VAX, were actually fairly nice for programmers to use if they were going to write in assembly language. And they probably turned out to be less of a benefit for compiler writers than the original designers of that instruction set might have hoped. I think as much as hardware engineers want to help the software, quite often they create more problems than they help in making these trade-offs.
Yeah, and actually I guess the simplified set of instructions is in some ways easier for a compiler writer. He doesn't have to worry about very complex instructions to figure out which ones they use at any given time.
Quite often the actual compiler writers prefer simple, orthogonal, regular instruction sets.
Yeah.
Is perfectly fine for what they're doing.
Yeah, this is actually
as long as you can process the instructions at a sufficient rate. And so if you could build, the theory was if you could build a RISC chip that processed instructions maybe at twice the rate, that if you use twice as many instructions, it didn't matter in the end. You'd still come out ahead.
So in the end, you and Professor Patterson wrote the case for a reduced instruction set computer, which sort of became the seminal paper in that time frame. Interesting stories behind that, and what was kind of the reception?
There was a huge amount of skepticism, and I think what made the paper interesting is it came out at roughly the same time with a paper called The Case Against RISC. As we had pre-circulated the paper, and I remember Doug Clark at Digital Equipment Corporation, who was one of the designers of the VAXs and the earlier computers at DEC, kind of, didn't believe in this at all. I said, you're just going back to building a PDP-8 or something. There's people kind of had little knockoffs on why they didn't think this was going to work without really fully understanding the concepts. Mm-hmm. And what I thought was really interesting was, three or four years later, Doug Clark himself wrote a paper called, we were wrong, this RISC stuff actually does work pretty well.
Was that before or after Alpha?
That was before Alpha. But I think along the way, they had a RISC architecture, I think you were to call Prism at DEC, that was kind of a step along that path. And even today, though, you can say, maybe RISC is one, because most of the complex architectures like the x86, both Intel and AMD, for example, kind of describe their implementation as breaking the complex x86 ops into simpler RISC-like ops.
Right.
AMD calls them ROps and Intel calls them UOps, but they're basically RISC-like operations.
Yes.
And so the question is, did RISC actually win inside? Well, you could say, well, maybe it did from that point of view.
I actually, from an architecture point of view, it did win. And I think Mike Johnson's book, The Blue Book, was the first one to actually drop that in his little textbook. Said, well, here you could do an x86 implementation by translating the instructions into symbol. Yeah.
And so I think that really makes the key point that you can separate the notion of the instructions that the programmer uses from how you implement it.
Right.
And so what they were really doing in translating into RISC-OPS was a form of binary translation. They were doing binary translation with, you know, hardware of, you know, one instruction to two or three RISC-like operations.
Yeah.
But that whole notion of binary translation can also be done by software. And so that led into a whole other set of fields of research.
Well, that leads us into Transmeta, but maybe before we do Transmeta, let's talk a little bit about your time at Sun, because I think that built up to what became Transmeta.
Yeah, and so I'd done some early RISC work at AT&T Bell Labs for about 10 years, but AT&T had kind of both gotten into and gotten out of the business within a few years, and I wanted to go work for a company that was really dedicated to RISC processors. So I ended up changing jobs, moving to California, and joining Sun Microsystems, when it was about maybe 1,000 people or so. Mm. And I had gone to school with Bill Joy and Eric Schmidt at Berkeley, and I'd actually tried to hire Andy Bechtolsheim from Stanford to come work at Bell Labs, because I was working on bitmap displays at the time, like he was working with the Sun Terminal. And in the end, it turned out to be the opposite. They ended up hiring me. I had a great time basically helping push forward a lot of different Spark designs, both within Sun and outside. A lot of my focus was on the instruction set architecture, the enhancing the 32-bit instruction set architecture they had when Spark was first announced. Mm-hmm. And then I led a team that developed a 64-bit extensions to Spark. And that was done in a fairly interesting way, because when you did something like a 64-bit machine, the tendency in the past was you throw everything away and you do something new. When you move from a 16-bit PDP-11 to a VAX, it was a totally new machine architecture.
Right.
And what was different about what was done with Spark was we did that extension in a totally upwards compatible way. And I think a lot of the lessons on that probably were perceived by AMD when they did the 64-bit extensions for x86 to do it in an upwards compatible way, mm-hmm. rather than throw it away and go to a new architecture like DEC did with the Alpha.
Yeah.
And while the Alpha was a really great architecture, very simple, very cleanly designed, the fact that it had to start from zero, again with binary compatibility, gave it a bit of a challenge there.
Yeah.
And so, you know, extending an architecture tends to be the easier thing that companies tend to do, even if it doesn't result in the nicest machine in the end. Just overall, there's a lesson there that a lot of the complexity and cruft we see in instruction sets that we don't like is there because of long periods of evolution.
Yeah, I mean, Intel tried going to Itanium for the 64-bit solution, and then that has pretty much flopped at this point.
I think Itanium had some of its own challenges, one by not maintaining compatibility, something that you would think they would have realized was important, but also
they sort of did. They had an x86 emulation mode that really ran very, very poorly, but it was there.
Not enough to make users happy,
yeah, no.
And I think there were some things designed into the instruction set of the machine, like defining the load use latency as part of the instruction set. Might have been great for the first implementation, but for the next couple of implementations, they were locked into things that in the end meant that they, on average, I think, lost about a factor of 2 in megahertz mm-hmm. compared to what the x86 implementation teams were able to do.
Yeah.
And although the Itanium architecture had some really nice benefits in parallelism, it's really hard to make up a factor of 2 that you've lost in megahertz.
Yeah, and then also the predication they built into it, I've talked to people that have indicated that when they looked back at it, that the extra cost of the predication was awash with the advantages of a predicated operation. So didn't really buy them anything.
So I've looked at a lot of new architecture designs, and I kind of have a rule that anytime somebody does a completely fresh generation, you'll tend to find lots of new ideas. And if you take maybe 100 new ideas in Itanium, or 100 new ideas in the 432, or you know, kind of any other major architecture, what you tend to find is maybe 10 of those 100 ideas turn out to be good ones, and the other 90 are ones that are just weighing you down. And so I think that the trick over time is to kind of learn how to evolve and pick the good things.
Mm-hmm.
And I still do not think even today the industry really understands well how to do brand new machines, how to take some risks in terms of new innovations, but how to
risk with a K.
How to figure out how to come up with, on the whole, really good things. Yeah. I think there's so much demand now that the first product you have out the door has to be a great success, that people are tending to do more evolutionary things. And so I think that's why we've seen a real slowdown in innovation in computer architecture.
Yeah, certainly it's anybody trying to build a brand new chip from the ground up, it's about a $100 million complex project.
Yeah.
And by the time you get that $100 million done, really got to start on the next one.
So that, in some sense, the economics were the impetus for starting Transmeta. When I was at Sun Microsystems, we'd had a number of Spark projects, but I realized at some point that if we looked at binary translation techniques, we could actually separate the notion of the physical implementation of the hardware from the instruction set you were running. Mm-hmm. The Spark CPUs, as a RISC chip, felt that they could build the hardware to be faster. But, with the notion of binary translation, we could take better hardware and move compatibility onto it. And so that was really the notion for starting Transmeta. And I think there's also a view that, big companies find it very hard to make big changes. Mm-hmm. And so by doing a startup, we knew that Transmeta would either succeed or fail, whether it made binary translation work. And Transmeta did binary translation of x86 code onto what was essentially a VLIW-style architecture with a completely RISC-like instruction set. You could put a number of 32-bit RISC-like ops together in one longer instruction word. And then the binary translator would figure out how to do exactly the same semantics the user had intended in x86 to do it on that hardware. And exactly how you design that instruction set to do that with high efficiency, I think, is really the key. But it's fairly clear now, something that wasn't clear then, that this could be done with high efficiency.
Now, did you have this idea when you were still at Sun? Or is this... These ideas about the VLIW and the emulation layer on top of that, did that occur?
The general notion of VLIW being a way to get good performance was around at the time. There were various companies like Multiflow and Sidrom and various DSP chips. Yeah. And while Spark started out as a nice RISC machine, and one of the fundamental principles of early RISC machines is, you do one instruction per clock. Mm-hmm. But with the quest for more performance, soon people wanted to do two instructions or three instructions. So in the end, you were ending up doing variable length. Yeah. And so one of the things about VLIW is just grouping those encodings together. And there's multiple kinds of VLIW, some with, giant fixed length like Multiflow. You had to have at least 32 instructions at a time.
And we should probably just for some people, VLIW stands for very long.
Very long instruction word, yeah.
Where you take multiple instructions and pack them into one operation.
So my view is a little more liberal in the definition of VLIW, which is to take, say, 32-bit RISC instructions and put a variable number together, but put encoding in the actual instructions to say how many of those instructions are put together. Mm-hmm. Because if you don't do that and have to do what's called superscalar execution, it takes a lot of extra hardware to look at all the instructions coming up, decide how many you can issue at a time, where are the dependencies, and all this can actually be checked very simply in software.
And you may have slots that aren't being used, so you have to put in no-op basic functions.
At times you can, So. And so, when we started Transmeta, nobody really knew if you could do that. Most of the binary translation work that was done prior to that was what was called static translation. Mm-hmm. And I think what was new at Transmeta was the notion that you could use dynamic translation and still be fast enough to actually outperform the pure hardware implemented processors.
And by static, you meant the compilers had to do all the code optimization ahead of time, schedule the instructions, a priori, and the problem I think is that a lot of people ran into is that that doesn't work well in environments where there's a lot of dynamicism, like say Java and such. You don't have all that static knowledge about at the compile time.
Yeah, and so again, a static compiler would try and take a binary for some machine. Maybe it was an x86, and translate it to say a lot of people say DEC had an alpha translator, right?
Yeah. IBM is also rumored to have it.
Yeah, various people tried this, but, you try and convert the whole program to a new program that you would run.
Yeah.
And again, there are some things that you just can't figure out at compile time. You don't know what two pointers point to the same thing or not, and so you have to have some runtime support. Mm-hmm. And I think what we learned in thinking about this at Transmeta was a little bit of extra hardware support to help the dynamic translator could make a huge difference. On a machine not designed for binary translation, mm-hmm. I think you can get within about a factor of two of native performance. It's about as good as people do. Maybe a little bit better, but not much. But with hardware support, you can actually come up to being equivalent or actually higher performance than a machine of similar hardware capability could be. Mm-hmm. And I think that's the trick, is learning what are those special hardware support operations you need in order to make binary translation go fast.
So how did Transmeta come together? Where did the funding come from? Who were all the people that you put the team that got put together to start the project?
Transmeta came together with some people who were maybe kind of a little disillusioned at various companies about how the projects weren't as exciting as they once were, mm-hmm. and wanted to go off and do something different, along kind of with the generalized notion that we had that you could virtualize the instruction set. And so actually implementing a particular instruction set didn't have to be the same in hardware as what you were going to run in the user program. Also, I think what was becoming very clear at the time was the rise in popularity of the PC architecture and Microsoft software together meant that there was this install base of software out there that the RISC world just hadn't kept up with. And so there was a clearly a large market there deserving to be served. And we felt that the very complex architectures implementing x86 purely in hardware at the time could be beaten by building VLIW techniques with binary translation. So it was a way to build a better mousetrap. Yeah. We thought we could do that. We had people with general expertise in the area, and it just kind of came together all at once that we decided, hey, let's go off and start a company. And so there was, a group of 8 to 10 people or something who got together. We got some initial funding from DARPA to actually go off and study some unrelated topic. We actually were studying cryogenic electronics at the beginning, and that gave us enough money to kind of get started, to get some initial concepts together, some data to kind of prove our point, and then we started off going and seeing venture capitalists. And this mm-hmm. was at a time when in Silicon Valley you could raise money for new microprocessors reasonably well. And so we got Transmeta funded that way.
And bootstrapped it. So, as the concepts were put together, you had was right from the very beginning of VLIW with code morphing was your initial concept, or did it evolve over?
No, it actually did not evolve very much. We knew at the beginning we wanted to do a VLIW-ish style architecture, in other words, multiple piece parts.
Yeah.
We had a concept of how to build a new type of binary translator, a new type of dynamic translator. In multiple stages that hadn't been done before.
Had any been any research papers on it before you guys did the work? Was there any research or that led into the binary dynamic?
We had seen some other work where people had just done dynamic translators. Let's say there was one experiment we had done trying to run MIPS instructions on the Spark architecture merely for comparing the two architectures together. And you typically have these benchmarking wars where you want to know how you're doing versus your competition.
Sure.
And so it was helpful from a tool analysis point of view to measure dynamic instruction frequencies not only on your own machine, but what does your competitor do, but measure them in the same tool suite. Mm-hmm. And what we had found is that by using a little bit of dynamic translation techniques that we could do within a factor of two of the native speed of the Spark while running the MIPS instruction set. Mm-hmm. And so the question is, well, where is that factor of two being lost? And as we thought about it, we realized that it was the mismatch between what you're translating from and to. And if that mismatch is too big, you can do it, but you have to have a longer sequence of instructions.
Yeah.
And so our notion was, look, if we went and did a custom designed instruction set that knew it was going to be translating from x86, we could do a RISC-like instruction set to translate to that we could translate to with very high efficiency. And so we ended up having to do the implementations from scratch after we started Transmeta. But this general notion that if we could get special purpose hardware support, that we thought we could do a much better job, and we knew we could already get within a factor of two of the base hardware, you know, even without the hardware support. And then we felt like we could build a computing engine that was more than a factor or two faster as well. So overall, the combination of those things led us to believe that we could build a substantially faster, simpler, lower power processor architecture by using a simple machine with binary translation on the top. And in the end, although we had to refine the technique somewhat, the basic technique was pretty much the same. Yeah. We learned that in binary translation, we needed to move from a two-gear translation system to a four-gear system.
Well,
that is to
say, I'll
explain that a little bit.
Sure.
So if you simply take a program and dynamically start to translate instructions one at a time, that's basically interpreting each instruction one at a time. That could be very slow. You could take 100 machine cycles to, you know, one native machine cycle. So 100 to 1 slowdown, that wouldn't be good. But if you try to binary translate large parts of the program, do a lot of optimization on it, you could find also you were taking too much time there. And so what we learned is to step up the amount of time taken during translation with the amount of optimization. What you'll tend to find in programs is that maybe 80-90% of the instructions being run very infrequently. So if you take a lot of cycles to run them, it doesn't really matter because you don't run them very often. But maybe 10% of the code is where you spend 90% of your time. And so if you can optimize that code very well, you can afford to take a lot of CPU cycles to do the optimization and then amortize that across all of the executions. And so balancing out how much time you take to translate versus what the quality of the code you should go there was one of the techniques Transmeta developed into what we called a four-gear binary translation system.
But as you do that optimization, you store that optimized code in basically a cache, so that rather than executing the original
so the next time you come back to it, you already have pre-translated code and you don't have to do the translation again.
And that's where you get your real speed up.
Now, these are techniques also that again, in 1995 when we started, people didn't know whether this was going to work very well. Mm-hmm. But in fact, another place where this has been used very successfully is the implementation of Java. So Java started off as an interpreted language.
Yeah.
Right, and then later they turned to dynamic translators and got very good performance. And those techniques tended to run in parallel. Mm-hmm. And again, translating from Java to the underlying machine worked pretty well. The job we took on at Transmeta was harder because we needed to get very good efficiency because we had to compete against hardware solutions. Mm-hmm. Plus, we wanted to run the operating system level instructions, which typically you don't have to do in a Java-style dynamic translation system.
Yeah.
So again, having the right hardware support underneath was what made the difference there.
Yeah. And you've given away from the idea of trying to do a Java machine and fully emulate Java or something like that.
And you know, I think because it crosses the boundaries of both hardware and software, it's a little difficult for people to necessarily accept. If you're a hardware person, you're skeptical of the software. If you're a software person, you're not really sure what hardware to get. But you know, slowly people are becoming more accustomed to this, and the techniques have gone on to be used elsewhere. NVIDIA has a CPU now called the Denver CPU, which uses techniques very similar to what Transmeta used. They actually licensed some of the Transmeta technology and hired some of the Transmeta people here. So there's a learning curve one gets on of learning how to do this better and better. I went off to Intel, and while the NVIDIA guys, the ex-Transmeta guys were there, I had a different set of ex-Transmeta guys at Intel, and we were studying similar concepts, but maybe along a slightly different direction that they had done, trying to advance the state of the art, and in particular to try and understand what is the trade-off between binary translation of VLIW versus doing binary translation on out of order. And I think that was not well understood, and probably today is not well understood. I think one of the things we learned at Intel is that binary translation on top of out of order actually worked far better than anybody expected.
Hmm.
And there was great controversy about that even while we studied the project. We had people on our own team that when we wanted to move from kind of a VLIW in order issue machine to out of order, simply said, look, it's impossible. You won't get more than about 5% more. I'll stake my reputation on that, right? Mm. And these were people who were very well respected in the architecture community.
And the concern was the out-of-order machine is much more complex.
Well, the feeling was, and this is something that's still said, for example, by the people in NVIDIA, that by rescheduling in the binary translator on top of in-order hardware, you get many of the benefits of out-of-order, and you're very close there.
Yeah.
And we believe that at Intel, and we pushed the envelope as hard as we could there. But in the end, we actually had the opportunity to do a nice experiment of also building an out-of-order engine and comparing those two and to see, well, would we get more than 5% or not, and would the hardware complexity explode?
Yeah.
The kind of the surprising thing, and I'll just say this in very generic terms, I'm not going to give away any real secret details that aren't very generally known in the industry now, but what happened as a result of that experiment was the hardware complexity only made the chip bigger about 5%. Okay?
Not too bad.
The performance almost doubled. And so I will say I was wrong about how much we could gain by having out of order. And I think the difference is that there are just certain things that are dynamic, like cache misses, TLB misses, other issues that are very difficult for a software scheduler to do before the program executes. And so I think it's an important notion to be able to handle these dynamically different events from things that are statically schedulable. So there's still a lot to be done in that area that I think will take the next 10 years before we see it to fruition.
So there's still a lot of interesting architecture work you think that still should be done?
I think there's a lot that could be done.
Yeah.
My dismay is a lot of it is not being done because so many of the companies that are still in business are doing small incremental steps. It used to be maybe 10 years ago at Intel had a tick and a tock scheme.
Yeah.
Right, a tock would be a completely new machine architecture.
Right.
And then when you move to a new process generation, they do a tick, which moved that well-established, known working architecture to a new semiconductor process technology.
Right.
That way you weren't taking the risk of process technology and architecture at the same time.
Right.
But what's happened is that, you know, because it's so hard to make changes, and the notion these days, this is my personal view, is a tick is maybe only a 5% change in the architecture, and a tock, instead of being 100% change, is maybe a 10% change,
yeah,
right, at most.
It's more refinement than it is any kind of
exactly change. Right. So people will, you know, learn, you know, I can improve this little thing here or there, but
yeah.
I think the rate, the pace of innovation has slowed down tremendously because people aren't willing to take the risks and the amount of learning curve it takes to get a new generation architecture going. So I still think there's some huge potential out
yeah.
there. There's factors of 2 to 4x, and there's people exploring various options. And I'm not sure I'm believers in all the different techniques out there, but I'm very delighted to see people you know, looking at these different techniques, because the other thing that's happened in the industry is there are many fewer companies actually doing new CPU designs. As I say, in the early days of RISC, there were maybe 100 companies doing their own RISC designs,
yeah.
because you only needed 2 engineers to do a RISC CPU, right? Now it takes several hundred engineers, and we're finding it's really down to, you know, a small number of companies, you know, Apple, NVIDIA, you know, ARM,
but they're doing
a few
those
others.
Under an instructions and license from
yeah.
ARM.
Yeah.
And ARM itself is fairly conservative.
It's not the same as a brand new computer architectures.
Yeah.
And it's very tough for universities to do because in order to beat the current machines, which are pretty good,
yeah.
right, the amount of effort and infrastructure you have to build is such that it's really not very practical at universities to look for a new breakthrough in computer architecture that way.
Well, what about your alma mater? They have their RISC V, RISC V, I guess it is.
Berkeley is trying to help people do you know, research and using processors by having a standardized instruction set and making
yeah.
it very open. But I don't think that the computer architecture work I've seen there is very innovative. It's more establishing a standard architecture that people want to put in an Internet of Things device and have free and open access. And I'm really a big supporter of that project from that standpoint, but I don't know that it really is helping us study instruction sets or, you know, new pipeline architectures or different methods of computation in a way. It's really, it's attacking a different problem.
Yeah, and actually in a sense though, maybe it's hurting more than helping, because by coming up with a fixed research architecture, where's the research in new architectures?
Yeah, so let me, I'll give you a particular point of view here, which I can say is one of the people who helped start RISC, is I think the RISC guys have gone off the tracks a little bit here. In two ways. You know, one, and this is something I felt when I was at Sun Microsystems, that a lot of the engineers felt because they were given a RISC architecture, a RISC instruction set to work with, that they would inherently be better than any complex instruction set architecture, and that just wasn't the case. When Intel doubled down and really put a lot of effort on the implementation, they found they could mimic and get around some of the inefficiency effects and build pretty good machines. And so that was, having a RISC instruction set is not a birthright that you will go faster.
Right.
You know, maybe it was a temporary advantage, and I think people had viewed it as a permanent advantage. I think at the time also RISC was being done. The machines we were competing against were machines like the VAX architecture and others that might have taken tens or hundreds of cycles per instruction. And by doing a RISC instruction set that was pipelined at one instruction per clock, we were making a conscious trade-off to get that constant throughput, even though it may take two or three times as many RISC instructions to do a program as using a more complex instruction. Yeah. And I think that's been forgotten by the world as well. If I look at the new 64-bit ARM instruction set architecture, it's a very generic RISC, and I think it's a really excellent RISC architecture, but it could have been done in the 1980s, right? Mm-hmm. So other than being 64 bits wide and having lots of SIMD instructions or something else, there's nothing terribly innovative there that couldn't have been done 20 years prior. Mm-hmm. And so I think that's not the be-all and end-all of things. I think there will be another wave in the future where there are more factors of 2 or 4x available just in basic instruction execution, which are available. And I think there's new opportunities for doing new styles of architecture. Something I'm personally excited about is how would you design computer architecture differently if you could think in 3D? So I think we're getting to the point where stacking chips in three dimensions is going to make the trade-offs differently, whereas it used to be that anywhere you could go on a chip was hundreds of times faster than going across chip boundaries to another chip. Mm-hmm. Well, now with 3D stacking, it's going to turn out that actually you can go to a chip on top of you maybe 5 to 10 times faster than you can go across your own chip. That means we ought to be rethinking computer architecture very fundamentally. Mm-hmm. In the regime of having technology which can do 3D stacking.
And in the case where you know 3D stacking, it's often it's a stacking memory on top of a processor, so that you get very high bandwidth access from the processor to the memory. Memory bandwidth has always been a battle, and that's one of always the arguments.
Sure,
CISC was an advantage. It had less pressure on the memory bandwidth than RISC.
Sure, but if it takes you, as technology shrinks, wire resistance is going up proportionately. It takes you longer to get at some units.
Right.
So if you're in the main CPU and you want to talk to your SIMD floating point unit, it may take a lot of clocks to go over across the chip. Maybe putting a SIMD unit on top of the main execution unit, you could actually get to it faster.
Mm-hmm.
So maybe we ought to be stacking our floating point units rather than just thinking of stacking memory. Stacking memories is something we should be doing. But there's, I think, more exciting alternatives that could be contemplated as well.
Well, so then again, it's thinking about stacking in 3D. So in a sense, you know, we need an architecture that can handle the interconnection of all these elements in 3D.
Yeah.
And that's an interesting.
I think that will open up some new opportunities for how we partition things.
Yeah.
I think one of the other things that has to happen still, we don't quite yet have today, is another generation or two of lower power electronics. If we can get new materials that help us have transistors that operate at substantially lower supply voltages, that will get the power on the chips down such that if you stack the chips, the cube of chips you've stacked doesn't melt.
Yeah.
That's still a little bit of an issue here. But you know, I think as technology changes in the future, I have every expectation that the power per die will go down such that you can stack chips without cooling problems.
Hmm. So that would indicate we need to start really thinking about some radically new ways of building processors and building computers
soon. I think there's some big opportunities there. So for any students out there who want to know what to study in computer architecture, thinking about, you know, how do you think in 3D might be a place to start.
Yeah. So actually now we're starting to get to a point where it's not just software and hardware and chip access, it's also packaging nexus.
The entire system will get integrated, right?
Yeah.
So today you've got, you know, your SoC and your DRAM and your flash memory and disk or whatever. Well, you know, we just saw even this week people make a major new announcement, a new memory type from Micron and Intel. for storage that's going to be maybe 10 times as dense as what we had seen before. Well, if we package that, you'll get the equivalent of, you know, all your CPUs and all your memory in one small cube in the future, right? Mm-hmm. And if it's got radio built into that, okay, so you apply power and it can wirelessly mm-hmm. communicate with anything.
And the power will be wireless too.
It's possible.
That was something we skipped over earlier, and I was one of your heroes. It was Nikola Tesla, who was big into wireless power transmission.
And of all the great things he did, that's the one I'm perhaps least convinced of. but it depends on the amount of power you need. If the power levels are extremely small, then wireless transmission is pretty reasonable. But with the amount of power we want to consume in our devices today, I think we're still pretty far off and able to do that in any widespread practical use.
So we still may get those kind of little cubicle processors and computers in the future that are super dense and super super interconnected.
Yeah, I think particularly with the push toward Internet of Things devices, you're going to want devices that are so low power that you can power them off a little hearing aid cell size small battery for 5 years, mm-hmm. right? When we can build our computing elements that are these little small squares, you know, that we can stick on the wall anywhere, and they've got video cameras and radio and are communicating with us. You know, perhaps we just need to take a giant box, throw a million chips in the box, and ask them to compute something.
Well, that's like the compute motes. They're just, you scatter about, and they interconnect to each other, yeah, through a mesh.
So there's interesting work to be done in computer architecture, but yeah, you know, I see less and less going on in the main CPU core each year, and so I think it's a little less predictable when we're going to get a next breakthrough.
Any idea where that would come from if it did come from somewhere?
Right now, very hard to see. Because very few companies are doing, again, the kind of mainstream computer architecture research. I think people think that computer design is a commodity, doesn't matter what your instruction set is, it's all the same. I don't really buy into that quite as much yet, but certainly I think there's less and less funding for doing new and innovative things.
Okay. I'd like to jump back first for a little bit. I've got to know you most when you started Transmeta, and you were very visible representative of Transmeta. How would you describe that whole experience of starting the company, becoming very well known, becoming the center of attention, and becoming the center of attention at Intel from a negative point of view? You were enemy number one at Intel for a while. And then the product, while it was very fundamentally successful in that it functioned well, ultimately the company failed. How would you describe that whole arc?
Well, a fascinating experience.
Yeah.
And so it was great to go through. I think it was a real opportunity to make bigger steps in architectural approaches that might have been possible at a larger company, because people just didn't want to take the risk. Mm-hmm. And for venture capital people, unless you make a big step, you're not going to get a big return. And so they actually do want to support you taking a big risk there. But you know, even at the time, it was difficult to raise money. We raised on the order of $250 million to get our first product out the door. And that's not an easy thing to do necessarily.
Yeah.
So there weren't a lot of companies doing that. It was great to be able to represent doing innovation, to go out, that helped us to go out and hire great other engineers. We assembled a great team of people.
Yeah, Linux, Linus Torvalds.
Linus and various others. I heard Linus say one day he liked working at Transmeta because he could feel like one of the average programmers. That sometimes he didn't like being treated special, which he gets treated specially sometimes for having done the Linux work, and which he deserves. But I think it was enough of a challenge, and other people found it was a great challenge. We weren't sure whether it could be done or how well we could do it.
Yeah.
And so I think that was great unexplored territory. You know, in the end, Transmeta didn't make it, and I'll just say here, I think it was not because of the technology. There actually turned out to be manufacturing problems. We switched fabs. Yeah. The fab we switched to actually had a problem and couldn't actually make our chips for a year. And we had to prove, where the issue was in the fab and what was happening. And, they're not happy if I speak too much about those details. But so the technology itself worked fine. And in fact, I was able to go to Intel. We started another team, and we had At one point, there were 200 people working on a project there, and they were all convinced that this was a good project to do, as well as many others, mm-hmm. Along with a fair number of skeptics as well. Yeah. But certainly convinced in the notion that this could be something really new and interesting that could provide some substantial benefits.
Yeah.
Now, in any project you do at any big company, it's not just a technology issue, you realize. There's a survival issue. As you go through and get approvals, you might have to go through 1,000 meetings where you get approval to go to the next step. It only takes one meeting to say no. And so in my career, I've done probably 20 different processor designs and pipelines, a lot of which have been canceled. And the first couple times that happens, it's extremely painful. But it's really part of the ecosystem you have to live in. Mm-hmm. That companies are going, conditions change, they need a slightly different product. I remember one project we had at Sun Microsystems. We were doing a gallium arsenide Spark CPU.
Oh, God.
Right? And it was going to have an amazingly fast cycle time for the time.
Yeah.
And we were doing
as
a full.
Is that a response to Cray doing their gallium arsenide?
We were using similar technology to Cray. And in fact, a little bit too similar. Cray and Sun were both using gigabit technology.
Yeah.
And what happened to the project at one point is Cray actually went and bought gigabit, therefore making the technology unavailable to other people. We looked at switching to a different gallium arsenide maker, and we could do that. And in the end, the decision came down at Sun that they are having challenges with another CPU project, and they needed to move the people on the gallium arsenide project over to a CMOS project that was going to be higher volume and needed to be done quicker. And so we ended up canceling something, and again, could have been fantastic. There was nothing technically wrong with the project.
Right.
But just business conditions are such that things change. And so, in a career as a computer architect, it may take 5 to 10 years to get a new project out the door. Mm-hmm. And in fact, in my experience, generally, a lot of brand new projects are about a 10-year curve. So if I look at what happened with the RISC microprocessors, for example, okay, we published the first paper on RISC in 1980. It was ridiculed for the first 2 years. Then as people started to do actual implementations and bring it out, it did it better. Then there was kind of a crest of RISC, and it kind of seemed like it was going to take over the world. And then the other people fight back a little bit.
Right.
And in some sense, some of the techniques for RISC that were appropriate for the technology of the day, for example, having a 32-bit fixed length instruction was really great for, 5-micron CMOS,
mm-hmm.
right? But we're nowhere near 5-micron CMOS anymore. Are those still the right trade-offs?
Yeah.
Much less clear. And so things tend to go down a little bit. And so we've seen the number of RISC architectures declining. Where it's basically just ARM that's left and a little bit of Spark on the side maybe and a little bit of MIPS
still.
Yeah. A tiny bit, but not they're not certainly in their glory days that they were before.
Well, PowerPC is still around as well,
yeah.
Although PowerPC is a fairly complex RISC processor.
Yeah. Transmeta took about 10 years. It takes a year or two to get the ideas together, to go out, to get funding, to get momentum, to build a team, to do an implementation. It takes 3 or 4 years.
Right.
It takes a couple years to bring it to market. What you'll find is you have to make trade-offs for expediency in the first generation that you're going to fix in the second generation. So by the time you get the second or third out, it's kind of a 10-year period.
Yeah.
And in doing projects at Intel as well, what I saw was their official methodology is such that it will take 10 to 15 years to do a new project because of all the steps of pathfinding and getting approvals and going to the next level and getting budgeting to get something to be a product. No senior manager would readily think that it should take 10 to 15 years, but in fact, if you look at what it takes to step through the process, that's what history has shown.
Yeah.
For going through that. And that's, again, very challenging if you want a career as a computer architect to say, hey, I want to sign up and do something, but I'm not going to see the result for 10 to 15 years.
Yeah.
And that's also a disincentive for doing brand new computer architectures.
Intel's last brand new architecture was the titanium, and as we mentioned earlier, wasn't a very successful experiment. So I think that's probably why they're a big gun shy. That's why they're pretty much x86 everywhere in these days.
Hard to explain why big companies do things sometimes.
Yeah. So we've talked about a lot of the different places you've worked over the years, and we talked a little bit about what you see coming in the market right now in terms of lack of innovation. Overall, and you're looking back at your career, what were your high points? What were the things that you felt were the most interesting, most challenging? Was it Transmeta? Was it the early work?
I think Transmeta was certainly the most interesting, because to do a software-defined processor had really never been done to that extent. People had done little bits of emulation of user-level code or something, but to really take on the entire architecture and say you could do it was something nobody knew whether that was really reasonable or not. Yeah. And now when NVIDIA ships the Denver CPU, nobody thinks twice about that as a technique. It's just commonly accepted. Certainly there was a lot of excitement about it at the time, and we had the internet bubble and things where everybody was very interested in processors. But you know, I think a lot of the work on Spark at the early days at Sun also had similar interest. And just the whole issue with getting RISC started, you know, most of the major computer conferences around 1980 to 85, you know, would have a RISC versus CISC debate panel session in the evening, right? Where we would yell horrible names at the other side about how stupid they were and not understanding our ideas, and it was entertaining.
It was great fodder in the 90s for conferences like Microprocessor Forum and such. I kept Michael Slater busy.
I say one of the, you know, a lot of the things that are very interesting to me in the past are also things which have not been visible to the rest of the world. When you work on a new microprocessor, quite often these are secret projects. And so you only know about the public projects I've done.
Right.
But there are a lot of other secret projects. And one of the projects that was very exciting was a project we started about 1991 or so, when I was at Sun Microsystems, when we went off and we hired the Soviet supercomputer design team. Mm-hmm. And this is a time when the Soviet Union was not doing well, it was breaking apart, people didn't have budgets anymore, and were looking for jobs. And what we were able to do at Sun was to go off and actually hire about 300 people who had built the unique Soviet supercomputers under the direction of Professor Boris Babayan. And in the Soviet Union, there were a lot of clones, but there were a few groups that did new design. And they had done some, you know, very interesting work in stack machines, tagged architectures, VLIW, and different kinds of binary translation as well. And so we had a large project at Sun Microsystems doing a VLIW Spark. It turns out that never came out. We got reasonably far, but that was about the time that I quit Sun and went to Transmeta. And after I left, I don't know why, but the project fell apart. And so, you know, projects like that were very interesting. Certainly the project I did at Intel was extremely interesting. Difficult in the sense that it was tough to get people to listen to enough of the details to understand why what you're doing was better. As opposed to, wait a minute, you're not in the geographic area that I'm in, and so therefore you're a threat to my business if you succeed.
Yeah, well, the kind of parochial interest within a large corporation.
But you know, trying to do something new was always very exciting, and you know, without saying what it was exactly, the opportunity we had at Intel was to replace all three of Intel's architectures, the Atom, the Xeon desktop, and the high-end Xeon Phi supercomputer, with one brand new architecture.
And that's pretty
It
radical.
Was extremely challenging, and that was the reason I gave it, as people said, well, why would you go to Intel? You know, everybody thinks you don't like it. Well, it was nothing personal. But if we could have made a change like that, that could have really changed the industry in a big way. And so that's why I went there for a while.
Yeah. Well, I mean, that certainly would have changed, a big change to the industry, and it would have had a large impact.
Yeah.
But then you also learned the hard part of moving a big, giant company that has a lot of inertia.
Things are hard to predict. And in particular, things that are hard to predict, kind of the lessons I would say is, you know, what you can do with your technology is actually far more predictable than the management structure you currently have in place. Mm-hmm. So as an example, when we did Transmeta, we were trying to sign up IBM as a fab and do a deal with IBM,
yes,
which we managed to do. But between the time we started the negotiation and the time we finished was almost 5 years later. We'd gone through five different vice presidents at IBM who were in charge of the deal. Because constant reorganizations keep changing things.
Yeah.
And so I think in terms of probably at least half the projects I've been on that have been canceled because of management associated changes. Mm-hmm. One way or the other, where you know the management team that was supporting you, you know, suddenly has, you know, left and gone to another company, and now new management comes in and they have their own ideas of what they want to do, and they don't want to give credit to their prior managers. And so projects, you know, suddenly change around. And that'll just happen on big, expensive projects.
But on a transmitter, you ran into a glitch trying to use IBM as a fab.
IBM was fine as a fab. We never had any trouble there. When we switched off of IBM, we had some challenges.
Yeah, when you had your problems, yes. If you'd stayed with IBM, maybe the part wouldn't have been as competitive in terms of process geometries, but at least it would have yielded parts. That was a problem.
There are always big company challenges, and one of the challenges we had with IBM is they had decided they were going to stop making bulk CMOS and only make SOI wafers in the future. That decision didn't last very long, but it lasted long enough for us to have to consider the implications of if our wafer price is doubled versus moving somewhere else for a fab.
We also had a back biasing technology. Would that have worked on the SOI?
We hadn't used that at the time. It probably would not have worked that way.
So that basically
by moving, and staying on standard CMOS, that was something we could continue to use.
Yeah. Now, SOI is trying to make another comeback as a interim step before you get to FinFET.
Could be. It'll be interesting to see where technology develops and what really catches on. But it's been very hard to beat standard CMOS just because of the volume production and the constant treadmill you're on for improvement.
What do you think about Moore's Law slowing down? Even Intel has admitted now that it's not 2 years between nodes, it's going to be 2.5 years.
Yeah, certainly things are slowing down in terms of technology development, and particularly the people are slowing down how they utilize transistors. For example, if you would spend a lot of effort to get a particular clock speed, if your transistor of the next generation is 20% faster, maybe you'll take 10% of that and just use it as efficiency benefits, and you won't worry about getting the maximum speed, right? And so clock rates have basically slowed down. The other thing that had helped the industry for a lot of the years is every technology shrink, your voltage dropped by about a factor of 0.7.
Right.
And that's now slowed down as well. And that was important because as you doubled the number of transistors, that voltage drop meant that you could keep the power levels reasonable because your power is related to your voltage squared.
Yeah.
And so that 0.7 drop gave you roughly half the power. And so you could double the number of transistors and end up with more or less net the same power.
Right.
Now that we're trying to double the number of transistors but not dropping the supply voltage, it's creating a real power challenge. And so people are having to work on a lot of issues there.
Well, that's why there's a fair amount of process work being done in sub-threshold logic to try to get down below 0.8, 0.7 volts.
Yeah, but things run very slow with sub-threshold logic.
Yeah.
And so the question is, can you use a lot of really slow processors to be as good as one really fast processor? It's been much more difficult for that to happen. In fact, a lot of the promise of multi-core maybe 10 years ago was, we'll just use 8 or 16 CPUs. You know, in the future, you're going to have notebook computers with 128 CPUs in them. So we don't need to build faster individual CPUs, right? That turned out not to work at all. You know, basically, and for most computers, 2 or 4 cores is about as much as most people will need on the desktop, and they have a tough time keeping those busy.
Yeah.
So having a fast individual core is still a very good thing. And the dream that we can take individual programs and split them up to run across multiple cores is still something that has not been realistically demonstrated, in my view.
At least not in the wide range of applications.
Yeah.
There are some, obviously parallelizable tasks like floating point, graphics.
Sure, stuff. If the task can be split up, that's one thing. And there's a lot of parallelism there. But taking an individual single-thread program and dividing it across multiple cores has turned out to be much harder in practice.
Yeah.
And getting people to break up their programs has also been harder in practice. So I think if there's a desire out there, people are able to explore as many cores as possible, but at some point you actually need each core to be faster. And so there's a desire for that as well.
Because the Amdahl's law part of the equation is still need a fast core.
So I think we still need better CPU cores.
We're not done yet there, I guess.
I hope not.
Yeah, I hope not, too. To go back to the Russian connection there for a second, that was interesting. Although it did fall apart, you said, after you left. Any follow-on to what they're doing these days?
Sure, quite a bit. So what happened was much of that team got picked up by Intel.
Mm-hmm.
And they went on to do a new, probably the single most innovative new architecture at Intel was there. And so when I joined Intel, I went and thought perhaps I could help him with that. I got assigned to do a different project, which I thought was also innovative and maybe a little more shorter term focused here, but I fully supported what they were doing as being extremely innovative there. And so that kept on, and I was able to keep a number of those connections. So in terms of where there's interesting work going on, you know, Russia is a place that's perhaps underestimated, particularly in software strength. There's a lot of good stuff going on there still.
We don't hear much about them on the mainstream press or media.
Yeah, mostly it's work they do on behalf of other people. So you'll see it on behalf of other companies.
And then, so we've talked about your career. We've talked about what you thought were interesting projects and your biggest challenges over your career. What are you working on now?
So I left Intel about 2 years ago and taking a little bit of a break. But what I've decided to do is to spend my time on things that I think are both personally interesting and which can maybe make a big challenge in the industry. So one of the things I've been looking at is 3D stacking of chips. And I think it's the obvious place to go. And the question has been, well, why hasn't 3D stacking taken off? And in my mind, the simple explanation is about cost. If you take four chips and you stack them on top of each other, and you use what seems to be an obvious way of interconnecting, what's called through-silicon vias. And for that, you drill a hole in the piece of silicon, you plate up like a printed circuit board, solder in between there, and you connect the chip with little solder bumps, it tends to about double the cost per die of those chips. So if you were building memories, the question is, well, who would pay twice as much cost per bit for memory in order to stack in 3D with this particular technique? So people have used other stacking techniques with wire bond and other things which aren't as technologically advanced, but then that limits their usage. So cost has been a really big issue there. And so one of the things I've been doing is helping a professor friend of mine, Professor Kuroda from Keio University in Japan, who has a very simple idea, which is to say, look, rather than having a special, expensive process you have to implement with drilling holes to the silicon, let's just lay the chips on top of each other and we'll have the chips communicate wirelessly. And it just seems like such an obvious idea. And he has a way of using very simple antennas. It's really just inductive coupling.
Okay.
You make a couple of turns of wire, maybe only 100 microns on a side or so. You put these coils on top of each other, and there's so much coupling between these two, it's almost as good as having a solid wire going between the two. And you can, you know, run these at many gigabits per second. They're extremely low power, maybe 100 times lower power than other forms of communication.
There's not that much loss between using the capacitive or inductive coupling?
No, there's no loss because the signal's transmitted and basically a cross-coupled latch on the output, and when the voltage pulse comes in, it'll transmit. And you just got just a standard digital signal there, right? So there's a little bit of analog circuitry to go through the analog coil, but fundamentally, it just looks like you're driving one gate on one layer, and the output comes out another gate on another die. And so I think this will enable people to think about how to design systems in 3D. And it will offer great opportunities for more density, smaller packaging, lower power, lower cost. And so I think maybe that will be the enabler that 3D has been waiting for, that all the previous approaches, which were too expensive, couldn't deal with. So I've been trying to be an advocate for that technology. I'm serving as advisor on a couple of with a couple of other companies, and maybe even looking at getting some new things started. So still tinkering in the back of my mind with some new ideas in processor architecture, and we'll see if those take off.
Yeah, well, you certainly haven't retired. You've just been in a lull here?
Taking things at my pace, and I'm not working for any other big company full-time right now.
Yeah.
So trying to explore the opportunities and see where things will go.
Well, that's cool. I mean, you've always been involved in very interesting projects, so I look forward to seeing what comes out in the future. Yeah.
One of the challenges in working at Intel was I had to be very isolated, didn't talk to contacts on the outside because I couldn't talk about what I was doing. So I think since I've left, I'm kind of using this opportunity to renew some contacts and see what other people are doing and, you know, try and understand what the next wave of opportunities are.
And then looking at those next wave of opportunities, we talked a little bit about there's still a need for better computer architectures. Do you see yourself getting back into that side of the?
Yeah, it's possible. I'm working on some deals currently. I think there's at least another factor 2 to 10x that's possible out there by, I'll just say, doing more simply designed architectures that are more matched to the application and combining that with how you take advantage of 3D. I think will be the big wave of opportunity in the future. So that's one of the things I'm exploring.
So, well, it sounds a little bit like a specialized architectures that you could combine various groups of the specialized architectures that do different things well, and then somehow connect all those together.
Well, I think particularly in the mobile world for tablets, phones, and Internet of Things, I think instruction sets and implementation techniques do matter still. And I think there's some big gains to be had. Now, that's not in the best interest of the vested interests who want to convince you their instruction set is the best, but I think for particular applications, it may not matter so much if you have an Internet of Things device what instruction set it is. Or even in phones and tablets. How we distribute applications these days has changed a lot from the last 20 years. Yeah. And I think that itself could enable a new generation of architectures. You know, once we stop having the applications being fixated on a particular implementation technique. If you look at the Apple Watch, for example, I think they've mandated that they're going to use a more independent form of submitting applications to the App Store using LLVM Bitstream. Mm-hmm. Maybe techniques like that will allow us to innovate new architectures without being tied into some backwards legacy instruction set. So I think the people who develop software take that in mind. That will help future hardware architects.
Yeah.
And one of the notions, is that, there may be a new chip every year, but software lasts forever, right? So what we need the software companies to do, the Googles and the Apples of the world, is to think about how they design apps. So that if that app is done and it's going to last for 20 or 30 years, how could you use that to implement something differently that's not so tied specifically to one particular machine instruction set or computer architecture? Hmm. So I think liberalizing those, and a lot of that is actually happening out there. And I use the example of the Apple Watch, it's actually happening.
Yeah.
I think what Google is doing with Android apps is extremely interesting. It's not tied to any one particular architecture.
As long as it's a well-behaved app and you use the
right. I think these will open up opportunities for future computer architecture that could be drastically more efficient than we see in current chips today.
Yeah. Well, even Microsoft tried to do it with their modern apps, where they were the same program that was could run on either an x86 or an ARM-based device. Seamlessly, and that was what they were one of the goals. Unfortunately, Surface wasn't so successful at implementing that, and the execution may not have been the problem. I think it was just still some issues with legacy. There's still a lot of legacy in the Microsoft world.
Yeah,
it has to be overcome. Cool. Where do you see? So we've talked a little bit about what you think the best next big thing is. We've talked a little bit about the future. What else would you like to say about? Where things are going, what your vision of the future is in computing. Is there any additional point you want to add?
I think how we do computing in the cloud for high performance computing applications is probably where there's going to be more innovation. For what I do on my phone, I expect this to be fairly evolutionary for a while. But I think the challenges of the size of the data centers, where you're limited to maybe 20 megawatts of power, how do you get more computing done there, is a big enough problem that people can afford to try specific new architectures to help out those type of data center computing environments. Mm-hmm. So I'm hoping to see some innovation there in what happens. I'd like to see more innovation in processor architectures than is happening now. I think we're kind of at a lull. Just the last year or two has not looked particularly good for me. in terms of what's happening. You know, we've seen people like IBM, you know, move their semiconductor business off to global foundries, which is maybe good from a fab point of view, but it's probably not so good in terms of people who are studying architectures who need to be closely tied with the fab. So, you know, I think that's going to become tougher and tougher to do. And I think there's going to be a concentration, particularly, say, phones and tablets, and maybe just, you know, the top three vendors or so who are driving all the designs. And the question is, how much will any of them be willing to invest? Some people are doing their own architectures. You know, others just, you know, pick up the latest thing from ARM, and ARM will supply the generic thing for everybody. So maybe ARM will do some innovative work.
We'd like to see that. What about what the very popular topic of Internet of Things right now, these very small connected devices that will be pervasive in our world? What do you...
I believe in pervasive devices that are all connected to a network by some radio. I want to be able to talk to my device and know, you know, what's the state of its battery on any sensor. You know, last thing I want is 50 sensors planted around my house and not knowing which ones have a dead battery in them because they can't talk to me, right? So that's really good. I think that's very interesting. I think a lot of companies are chasing this, though, without perhaps knowing how to monetize it. I think that's more the question I have. If you can make Internet of Things chips very, very small, maybe you can make a few million chips just with a, you know, small number of wafer lots. It's not going to keep the fabs full. And so I think there's going to be some disruptive economics coming as you know, Moore's Law continues to some extent and die sizes continue to shrink. It's hard for people to spend enough money to fill up all those transistors, you know, in the way that we used to. And so what I think is going to happen instead is they'll actually take that in terms of cost reductions. So hopefully we'll get cost reductions there, but that will mean that there's, you know, less money coming in made to innovate on other new designs.
Well, in a sense, though, with Internet of Things, a lot of the devices may stop at a certain process node. 28 seems to be sort of like a sweet spot in terms of cost.
It's going to be cost, a cost-driven basis, maybe a little bit
of
power.
But if everything sort of comes to a abrupt halt, a large volume of these dies coming to, say, 28 and say, okay, I'm done, I'm not going to go to 20 or 16 FinFET or anything else because it's too expensive, who's going to fund the next generation?
That will be the challenge in economics here, yes.
Yeah.
And while you're in a growth mode, it's really great to fund new fabs and do that. But again, I think you're absolutely right. It's going to be one of the challenges in electronics. So I think we're going to see a big slowing down in terms of how rapid the advances are. I think there will still be advances, but people aren't going to move to the next node unless there's a significant cost advantage. And it used to be that cost advantage was very clear. And then a few years ago, I remember one large graphics maker complaining that from their fab, they were paying more dollar per transistor doing a shrink than they were just staying where they were. And that's just not economically interesting to many people.
Yeah, but in order for higher performance, you do need, process shrinks are an important part of that. 3D stacking may be one of those alternatives where people mix and match various process nodes depending on what they need. And then they can vertically stack and get the density.
What we've seen in NAND flash is people actually going backwards in terms of lithography so they could stack higher. so some of the 3D NAND flash from Samsung, for example, or Toshiba, others are doing that, where they're actually going to coarser metal geometries so they can actually grow in the vertical direction without having to stack multiple chips. They just do this by growing lots and lots of metal layers. You know, I've seen people doing maybe up to 100 layers of metal. I think could be coming reasonably soon as a technique. And I think that's in part because the cost of stacking multiple individual chips is too high. And so I think we'll see lots more in terms of density, but it's not clear to me that we're going to be holding, you know, handheld devices that will be 10 or 100 times faster in terms of, running single-threaded apps for us.
Yeah, well, that's single-threading seems to be a big challenge, and we haven't really solved that challenge in architecture.
We've got to teach people to program differently, perhaps, but that doesn't seem to be on the horizon.
They've been trying to do that
horizon.
For like a long time now. It's been 10 years, and it still hasn't changed significantly yet. So one last thing, do you have any career advice for young people who might be getting into this industry, this crazy industry that we've been working in?
Yeah, engineering's always good, and you know, software in particular is still, I think, pretty strong.
we need chip architecture.
What we're doing in chip architecture, I'd say, is pretty sobering. in terms that a lot of the jobs are not going to be in the U.S. And I think that's a real challenge people need to get used to. I think it's moving to Asia. And so a lot of the traditional electrical engineering, VLSI type jobs, I think you need to look pretty hard at exactly what is it you want to do and where are you willing to live in order to do that. And I think we can see that a little bit in Silicon Valley here by how little money is going into new chip startups and more money that's going into software companies, social networking, a little bit of Internet of Things, not so much. But just generally, software-oriented approaches, you know, I think there's a lot to be done in software, and that's the great part about software. You get powerful hardware underneath, the software can do lots of different things with it, right?
But the software has come to expect that the hardware is going to continue to get more powerful and smaller and cooler over time. If that starts stalling, that may have a negative impact on the whole ecosystem.
Well, then we're going to need more trained engineers to solve that problem and come up with some breakthroughs.
Yeah, exactly. So we need to break through this architecture barrier that we're in.
Yeah. But generally, just good, you know, science, engineering, math, helping engineering move forward would be the advice I'd get for young people these days. I think there are always going to be very good jobs there. You may have to look around for exactly where you're going to work physically, but there will be things available.
Okay. Any final notes that I've gone through?
No, just great. Hey, I appreciate the chance to be able to talk a little bit. There's so many interesting projects, and I hope that the engineers for the next 50 years are going to find as many interesting new CPU designs and find it as exciting as we found in the past 20 years.
Yeah. Now, so how many of your old projects are in the Computer History Museum?
I think there's a fair number of pieces in the Computer History Museum. Right now, there's a wearable computing exhibit. And I've certainly seen some of the companies, and I've been involved in many, early wearable devices, which were very clunky to today's standards here. And you can see people wanted to do it. And, you know, I think one of the challenges Transmeta had is, you know, having very low power x86 CPUs, we enabled people to do lots and lots of prototypes, and we spend a lot of effort there. But people would build demonstration units, and they'd make maybe 100 of them. And you've got to have somebody, you know, sell, you know, 1 million to 10 million units of something to make a business out of it. Yeah. So lots of demonstrations. People are still trying to figure out what are we going to do with it. We hear about Internet of Things. I don't think we know exactly what's actually going to happen. I think we're going to look back in 10 years and laugh and say, that's what we thought they were going to do. Well, they did something completely different. But you know, I think the pace of innovation is exciting, and I certainly hope it continues. I think having devices get continually smaller, particularly with 3D stacking, is absolutely going to happen. As we get the lower power of electronics, we'll be able to do more in smaller spaces. You know, will each device though be substantially more powerful? That's less clear. I think it's more of a cost reduction, a power reduction. With some increase in features is more likely to be what happens in the predictable short term.
Well, we've got that down on record now for you saying that, so we should come back 10 years from now and revisit all this and see if it's changed much.
I'd be happy to do that. Thanks very much, Kevin. Okay, take care.
Thanks a lot, Dave.